Hey there, and welcome back to the Parkinson's Disease Education Podcast. We've got a big episode for you today, and I think you're really going to find this interesting, but it could be a little bit overwhelming, so I wanted to warn you and have you take a deep breath before we start. Cleansing breath, let's go. I feel so much better now. Anyway, now that that's over with, what we're going to be talking about in this episode, as the title implies, we're going to be diving into the role of the protein alpha-synuclein in Parkinson's disease. But even beyond that, we're going to be going into the cellular biology and how alpha-synuclein affects the cell functions, particularly with dopamine neurons. I promise you I'm going to make this as straightforward as possible. You don't have to be an expert in anatomy or neurology or anything to understand this, but it is deep. So just a fair warning before we go into the episode today, what we're going to do in part one is discuss what I just mentioned, alpha-synuclein, its role in Parkinson's disease, some of the genetic links to Parkinson's disease that involve that protein, as well as kind of how that all plays into Parkinson's and those pathologies. In part two, I'm going to cover what possible remedies there are to help mitigate or make this problem better in persons that already have Parkinson's disease, better yet, hopefully to prevent Parkinson's in those that haven't developed it yet. I'm not going to promise that it's going to happen, but it's a very important concept to try to be preventative versus reactive. So sit back, fasten your seatbelts. One more deep breath, and cue intro. Welcome to the Parkinson's Disease Education Show, where we demystify the disease and empower you as the person with Parkinson's disease to reach your true potential. The content contained on this show is for informational purposes only and is not meant to be a replacement for information or advice that you receive from your in-person medical or therapy professionals. If you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing, and for an even more personalized experience, please ask us about our memberships. Now, without further ado, let's start the show. So first of all, what is alpha-synuclein? So alpha-synuclein is a protein, and it's a protein that tends to be found in the cells, particularly in the brain cells, and we do see that presence of that protein typically. Actually, even in normal persons without Parkinson's disease, that protein is present even in dopaminergic cells, such as in the substantia nigra, where Parkinson's disease tends to cause cell death. So alpha-synuclein is often found as what's called a monomer. It's a single protein structure molecule, but that single monomer of alpha-synuclein, the kind of the role of what that plays in the cell health is a little bit up for debate. However, what's really important and where the rubber meets the road for this episode is how alpha-synuclein, when it's overproduced and aggregates, causes a lot of, if not all of, the problems that we see with Parkinson's disease. Let's unpack that a little bit more. One important thing to remember to keep in your memory bank for later in the video is that alpha-synuclein, when it aggregates, it causes some specific problems at the cellular level, but overall, as a big problem, alpha-synuclein is what results in what we call Lewy bodies. So those aggregates, when they become so large that they can be seen as large clumps, essentially, those are called Lewy bodies, and that's where you can get the development of Lewy bodies in the brain and what could lead to down the road to Lewy body dementia. I won't go into Lewy body dementia as a primary diagnosis in this video. I'll link a video to that up above so you can learn about that a little bit more. But suffice it to say for this video that Lewy bodies are one of the largest results that we'll see from alpha-synuclein aggregation. However, even on a smaller level, you can see alpha-synuclein in nerve tissues, even peripheral nerve tissues like your sensory nerves in the skin. And in fact, there are tests out there like the SYN1 test that look for alpha-synuclein in those peripheral nerve tissues in various points in the body. They put that result together and form a positive test result for Parkinson's disease. Alpha-synuclein has also been found in the vagus nerve or cranial nerve 10. That's the nerve that really controls a lot of bodily functions, but most specifically controls our gut function. And so with that gut-brain connection that you might hear about sometimes, there's a lot of debate as to whether Parkinson's disease starts in the gut and moves up the vagus nerve to the brain, or if it's from the brain and moves down to the gut. For this video, it's not really that important, but alpha-synuclein is a very important protein to keep in mind. We're going to move on from alpha-synuclein specifically to talk about some cellular functions, and then we're going to circle it back and tie it in with alpha-synuclein and other functions of the cell. So now we need to talk briefly about mitochondria. Mitochondria, if you go back to the annals of your memory to your first biology class, you probably remember learning about mitochondria and the adage that the mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell. Rightly so, because mitochondria produce the molecule ATP, or adenosine triphosphate, and they produce that through a cycle called the citric acid cycle, or the Krebs cycle. So with ATP production, that's what gives us energy. That's what gives our cells energy. Our muscles function with ATP. ATP is crucial. It's everything. It's the currency of the body for energy. But mitochondria do way, way more than just produce ATP. In fact, they're a very, very important organelle for multiple reasons. One reason is that they produce essentially the DNA of every cell, and they're found in every cell in the human body. And the DNA of mitochondria varies depending on the type of cell that they're found in. Mitochondria affect cellular function. They affect what chemicals certain cells produce. Mitochondria can send messages within the cell for cellular function and health. Mitochondria can even send messages that will make it to other cells. We're not going to go any deeper into function of mitochondria, but just keep in mind that mitochondria are crucial for protein productions, for cellular functions, and in the dopaminergic cells, which are found in the substantia nigra, mitochondria are going to be a key factor in how much dopamine is produced and how well it's released into the cells it's supposed to be going to. Now, at this point, it's worthwhile to pause and to talk about a couple of really important terms with regard to cellular health. The first is autophagy. The second term is mitophagy. And I'm going to define each one of those and explain those. So autophagy is a cell's ability to find misfolded proteins or damaged parts of the cell and essentially to break those down and to recycle those parts, reuse them for something else. So think of it as your cellular recycling center. It's going to take those damaged parts and break them down so that they can't cause problems down the road. The second is mitophagy, and that's the abilities of the cell to find sick or damaged mitochondria and destroy them. So autophagy and mitophagy have a really important role in what we call the endolysosomal pathway. What's really the most important to know about the endolysosomal pathway and the purposes of this video is to know that that pathway is damaged in Parkinson's disease. That's linked with alpha-synuclein, it's linked with impaired autophagy and mitophagy, and it's linked with the function of lysosomes within damaged cells. Again, I want to briefly pause just to give you a couple of terms and their definitions, and then we're going to move on. An endosome is essentially a cell's storage facility. Think of an endosome as like a pocket of material that the cell uses and distributes around the cell as needed. Once it gets to its destination, it opens up and whatever is in there can come out and be used by the cell. A lysosome could be thought of as a cell's incinerator. An endosome will travel to a lysosome within a cell, and then the lysosome breaks that down. Lysosomes also play a key role in programmed cell death, or apoptosis. Apoptosis, by the way, is controlled directly by the mitochondria of that cell, which, if you remember, mitochondria that are damaged will cause problems with cellular function and possibly even cell death. That's one of the key factors I want to talk about in this video. So, it's worthwhile talking about genetic links to Parkinson's disease. While there are many cases of Parkinson's disease that are so-called idiopathic, meaning there's no known cause, there are very specific genes linked to Parkinson's disease, although not every case is genetic. In the paper that I'll link in the description below, the endolysosomal pathway that we talked about a few minutes ago has been shown to be impaired in persons with Parkinson's disease even when there is no genetic link. That's something important to remember. But for the purposes of this, I want to make sure we at least briefly touch on these genetic links and how that relates to alpha-synuclein and other malfunctions. There are many Parkinson's related genes, but there's a few specific ones I wanted to mention. There's LRRK2, PARK8, PARKIN, and PINK1. And again, there's a few more other than that, but those are some very specific ones that are linked with specifically sick mitochondria within the cells of the substantia nigra. Just keep in mind the simple fact that those gene mutations tend to result in, or one of the most common results is sick or damaged mitochondria within the cells that produce dopamine. And so damaged or sick mitochondria tend to result in alpha-synuclein aggregation. The aggregation is the key word because, as we mentioned earlier, alpha-synuclein is perfectly normal to be found as a single molecule or monomer, but when it's aggregated in large clumps or masses, it tends to be very problematic for the cell and for dopamine production. That's what we're going to go into now in terms of cell biology and in how it affects dopamine-producing nerve cells. Now, I'll just solicit the help of my handy-dandy whiteboard so that we can talk about this a little bit deeper. One, two, three, and whiteboard! And there it is! So, I'll bring you in a little closer so we can look at this in a little more detail. Okay, so all this nonsense on the board is essentially what we're looking at on a micro scale with a single dopamine-producing neuron going to a secondary neuron that's going to receive that dopamine. Dopamine, being a neurotransmitter, is sending a signal from one nerve to the other for a function to happen. It could be something like picking up your foot to move it or blinking. Regardless of what the function is, we're going to be looking at how this part blown up to here is affected by alpha-synuclein and these mitochondrial issues we've been talking about. So right here, you're going to see a neuron. This one is leading with the axon to what's called a synapse. A synapse is just a connection between one nerve and the next. So whether it's a chemical communication, like in the case with dopamine, or it's an electrical communication in the case of an action potential, it's going to travel from the nerve itself down the axon to the synapse. It'll go from one cell to the next. So if you take this part here, our synapse, and blow it up, it looks a little bit something like this. You've got the presynaptic neuron on this side and the postsynaptic neuron on this side. These small circles with little dots in them represent what's called a synaptic vesicle. Essentially, that vesicle contains a chemical of some kind, a neurotransmitter, for example, and that will come into the synaptic cleft and travel to the postsynaptic neuron. So it comes from here and it gets into a vesicle, it's released into the cleft, and then it's received by the opposite side. All of this is mainly just to summarize the point that alpha-synuclein aggregates damage synaptic vesicle production and function. So essentially, with alpha-synuclein presence and the cells that have damaged mitochondria that produce dopamine, this function malfunctions. So think of these little dots as dopamine. With a dopamine-producing cell that's damaged, maybe you get that much dopamine. I'm exaggerating a little bit for the purposes of this example, but I hope that you can see that that's on the micro level what's going on in the brain and all those cells that produce dopamine in the substantia nigra pars compacta. As they're damaged and then dying off, the dopamine production is drastically, drastically lowered. Well, I think for today, Magical Whiteboard's done his job. So thank you, Whiteboard. We'll see you again next time. One, two, three. So we're gonna get lost in the woods if we keep going, so I'm gonna stop it there. But just in summary, alpha-synuclein is a normal protein when found by itself within cells, but when it's aggregated or grouped, it's abnormal and it can cause really bad problems with the function of dopaminergic cells, particularly when we're talking about the synapse of a dopamine-producing nerve cell and a neighboring nerve cell it's trying to communicate with. So the synaptic vesicle function is damaged. That may directly result in decreased dopamine being transported between those nerve cells. Alpha-synuclein also affects cellular health in terms of inhibiting normal functions like autophagy, the cell's ability to find damaged parts and to break them down and reuse them. Well, I know my brain hurts after that conversation, I want you to ask questions, and there's no dumb questions, so please let me know in the comments if you need clarification on what we talked about. So preview of the next video is, can we do anything to improve the health of the cells in the brains, particularly at the level of the mitochondria, as we discussed in this video? There's a great book called Brain Energy by Dr. Christopher Palmer. I'd like to link in the description below. I'm going to be talking a little bit more about lifestyle changes, potentially dietary changes that may result in improvements in cell damage resulting in Parkinson's and caused by Parkinson's disease. That's it for this podcast. Thank you so much for being here today. I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. As always, be empowered.